the Lord and worship the Lord this whole time. I was just thinking about, as Michael was praying, how we address God as our Father, and He indeed is our Father. He is the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it is His design in how He made man. In Genesis 1:26, He said, "Let us create man in our image, in our own likeness, let us make him." And so He created him male and female, and He blessed them, and He told them to be fruitful and multiply. The relationship that the Father has with the Son, with the Lord Jesus Christ, is the very example of what He wants us. It is the very design that He has instilled in the family. And I was thinking about this this week. I know there have been times, and I understand, and we try to be really sensitive over the years. We don't know the answer to this. There are men and women who want to be parents, but they're not. And but I thought, in spite of the fallenness of our world, and in spite of the imperfections of our world because of our fallenness, we want to celebrate, like on a day like this, especially in the midst of a culture that tries to redefine what it means to be a family, what it means to be, what comprises a family, where a dad especially is not only made fun of television sitcoms and commercials, and is the butt of jokes. But now they're saying that families don't even need dads, that they can have two women as the parents, like Heather has two mommies, and that's okay. Well, it is not okay, because the Word of God says it is not okay. There's beauty and grace and wisdom in the design of God that's made for us. I want to read to you his name is Harry Reader III. He's a pastor. And he was talking about his dad who had died while he was playing golf with a family. He didn't make it to the 18th hole. He collapsed and died. But he said it was a very appropriate thing for the family, because that was his dad's life, was always spending time with the family. But he said, "If I had been with him after saying, 'I love you, Dad, and thanks,' I would have mentioned many other things I was thankful for, and here are a few of them. Thanks, Dad, for being my best friend, being my father, and I never wanted another, being my coach, not only in sports, but in life. Thanks, Dad, for making me so proud of you, always calling me son, giving me mom, and three great sisters. Thanks, Dad, for teaching me how to hit a baseball, how to shoot a basketball and block out for a rebound, to make a wrap-up tackle in football, and sharing the joy of a round of golf on a summer afternoon with my best friend, you. Thanks, Dad, for teaching me the joy of reading, the excitement of history, the magic of stories and storytelling. Thanks, Dad, for showing me how to love, honor and respect my parents by the way you love yours, taking me into your everyday life, sharing with me the places you grew up and the stories of your life in those same places. Thanks, Dad, for showing me the importance of family and how to be a dad, and how to both work hard and play hard. Thanks, Dad, for not sending me to church, but taking me, giving me wisdom about how to live life and to enjoy life, explaining how I could have eternal life in Christ, reminding me that God's grace is greater than my sin, returning to the Lord, finishing strong, and seeking to bring others across the finish line with me. Thanks, Dad, for being my daddy, giving me your name to both bear and wear for life, loving me, and for not only being my dad, but also for being my hero. And thank you, Lord, for giving me not just any dad, but one who became my best friend and hero." Now, this may not be the expressions that you can say about your dad, or it may truly reflect what it is that you have, the feelings that you have for your dad, gratitude to the Lord that you have for your dad. And we need to thank the Lord for the wisdom that He's given us, for giving us the dads that we have. And we also want to honor and celebrate the wisdom, the beauty of the design that God has given us in the family, to have a man in the family. And so right now, I want all of the men in the church, whether you have a child or not, but if you're a man or you're expecting a child, as I see somebody, it's a fine looking fellow, his last name is Fine, so I say that. But all the men, I just want all the men to stand up. And we want to honor you and we want to pray for you. Would you do that? We have a small gift for you. And if you'll remain standing as you receive this gift, and we thank the Lord for raising you up in our families. Go ahead, guys, and just hand him a gift. I don't know if you noticed what it is. It reflects what I love. It's a flashlight. But it really is a symbolic of the light of Christ, that for him to light us the way, the word of God is the lamp of our feet and the light of our path. If you'll remain standing here, I just want to have a time of prayer for you guys.
Father God, we thank you for the fact that you are our Father, that we can come before you today and that we can call you by that name. Father, we know that that is only because you have chosen us. And we thank you each and every day for the fact that you have done so. Father, we thank you for the example that you set for us, for how our earthly fathers are to love and protect. Father, we thank you for those that you have given us. Father, I thank you for the godly men in this place today, for the way that they point their families to you, Father, for the love that they show not just their children but their wives. Father, we know that the only reason they can do that is because they love you. Father, you have given us such a great gift, such a precious gift in these men. I ask, Father, that you would continue to lead each and every one of them. Father, that they would spend their life modeling your great love to their children and to their wives. Father, I pray that as a result of their influence in the lives of their families, that their children and their children's children and their children's children, Father, that goes on and on, look back to these men that are here today and talk about what a godly example each and every one of them were. Father, I ask that you help them, that you guide them, that you direct them. Father, that they lean on nothing but you, that they are immersed in your word, Father, and that their heart is fully turned and fully given over to you. Father, we thank you again because we know that every good gift we have is simply because you have chosen to give it to us. Father, make our hearts ever grateful for all that you have done for us. We thank you most of all, though, Lord, for your Son, Jesus Christ, and for the sacrifice he made for us. And because of that, we can enter into a relationship with you and truly call you Father. It's in his precious and holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, man. Please be seated. Open your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 38. The last couple of 3 weeks, I've been asking everyone, I don't know why I cannot remember when Father's Day was or is, but I said, is this Sunday Father's Day? Because I was trying to figure out how the series of the book of Isaiah falls into that, and I was going to do something else to challenge our dad. It happens that we are in chapter 38, and that's an aspect of our life as believers in Jesus Christ that is so important that I thought this is a perfect chapter for us to look at in chapter 8. This is the prayer of King Hezekiah when he became ill and the Lord told him he was about to die. And I've entitled the sermon, really, I took it from James, "The Prayer of a Righteous Person is Powerful and Effective." I know we struggle. Prayer is one of those areas of our lives that I know for myself, it is one of those areas that I had to force myself to be disciplined about. I could read forever, for hours, literally hours, and spend time in the Bible, just reading and studying, and reading books and all of that, and be able to share my faith. But prayer has always come very hard for us. But it's also one of the most important things. Prayer and the Word of God, spending time in the Word of God, are two things that's, it's like breathing in and out. It's breathing. It's inhaling and exhaling. It's a part of us. And I want us to look at this man, this king, this godly king, and see what he did, what was happening to him. You don't have to turn there, but I don't think I've read this part to you from Second Kings in the Chronicles of the Kings in Second Kings chapter 18. We know from the chapter that Hezekiah was the son of Ahaz. This is just defining who he is. Who was Hezekiah and what kind of a man and king was he? He was the son of Ahaz, and Ahaz, his father, was an evil king. He was the one that we met in Isaiah chapter 7, who would not trust God, and he would even mock God. His mother was Abijah. He was 25 years old when he started his reign. He ruled in Jerusalem for almost 30 years, about 29 years. He did what was right. This is what the scripture says. He did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, just as his father David had done. Now, that is a way of saying, when you see that, you might say, well, I thought his father was Ahaz. It means he's from the lineage of David. And one of the things he did was he removed the high places. You remember in Psalm 121, it says, "I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from?" Well, the hills were the places where the pagans worshiped their idols. And in Canaan, that's where they worshiped the Baal and Ashtaroth, or the Asherah poles. And what he did was he removed the high places, smashed the sacred stones that they were using for idol worship, and cut down the Asherah poles. Asherah poles were fertility poles that they were using. They were bowing down to these things and worshiping them. So he cut them all down and he broke them. He also, you remember the snake that Moses had, that God told Moses to make, the bronze snake, where when people looked to it after they had been bitten by a snake, and they would be healed, they would be saved, and they would not die. Well, guess what? They were worshiping it. So what does he do? This godly king, well, his heart was so fervent for the Lord, he destroyed that very thing. Not only that, it tells us in 2 Kings chapter 18 that he trusted the Lord. Now you might say, well, what does that mean? We've been talking about that. That's been the essence of the whole book of Isaiah. You can trust me. God says, you can put your faith in me. What I have said, I will do, and you can bet your life on that. But often, as we have seen, Ahaz did not believe that, and even King Hezekiah at one time did not. But he trusted the Lord. Generally, in his life, he trusted the Lord. And it says, the account in Kings says that there was no one like him among all the kings of Judah, either before him or after him. And I know what some of you are thinking, what about David? Well, it specifically says in the kings of Judah, in the southern kingdom. So here's a very, one thing we can read here is that in the scripture, it does tell us. He was a very godly king devoted to the Lord. And not only that, it was proven by what he did, by destroying those idol places of idol worship. But it also says in 2 Kings 18 that he held fast to the Lord and did not cease to follow him. And then the last thing that the text tells us in verse 6 of 2 Kings 18 is this, that he kept the commands the Lord had given Moses. He kept their commands. Well, as a result of that, 2 Kings tells us that the Lord was with him and that he was successful in whatever he undertook. And then it gives us the description of what were those things that he undertook. It says he rebelled against the king of Assyria and did not serve him. He defeated the Philistines as far as Gaza and its territories. And if you remember your Old Testament history, you remember what God told Joshua before they went into the Promised Land, before they Deuteronomy was, they were part outside of the promised land of Canaan. What God had said, I will let you go into this land. And remember what God tells him in Joshua 1:8. It says, do not let the book of the law, the book of the law, depart from your mouth. But meditate on it day and night so that you will be careful to do everything written in it. He says, then you will be prosperous and successful. The prosperity and success that God was telling Joshua here was the prosperity and success of occupying the land, of being successful in the military conquest of the land. He already told him that in Deuteronomy chapter 7. He says, when you go into the land, it says you face this nation, seven nations more powerful and greater than you. And when I have defeated them and I have handed them over to you, it says you shall destroy all of them. And so God was the one, they knew, Joshua knew this. King Hezekiah knew this, and so he wanted to follow the Lord. In fact, Joshua was so aware of that, that in Joshua chapter 8, after they had conquered Jericho, and then God chastised them for what Achan did in the city of Ai, the first thing that he did is he gathered the people and he read them all the words of the law of the Lord, because that is so important. But we also know from the 2 Kings account that Hezekiah was not a perfect man. No one in this world can be perfect in the way that God wants us to be perfect. How do we know that? Well, yeah, he rebelled against the king of Assyria, but when push came to shove, he thought, okay, they've defeated not only the northern kingdom, now they've defeated the cities of Judah, and now they're coming against me. And so what he did was he tried to bribe the king of Assyria. Well, this account in chapter 38, and really in chapter 39, introduces something for us. 39 will introduce to us the story of Babylon. But here in 38, this happened before the king of Assyria came against them, in the chapters we had just seen previous to this. Look at verse 6. It says, and I will deliver you and this city from the hand of the king of Assyria. So he hasn't done it. Although in 37, we saw that God had destroyed in one night 185,000 men in the Assyrian camp. That happened in 37. So this is looking back to what happened before they besieged Jerusalem. Well, let's just look at what happened here. In verses 1 through 8, we find that Hezekiah was ill. Verse 1, in those days Hezekiah became ill and was at the point of death. The prophet Isaiah, son of Amos, went to him and said, this is what the Lord says, put your house in order because you are going to die. You will not recover. So that was the announcement. Not only of his, he knew he was ill, but God tells him through the prophet Isaiah he was going to die. Now that presented a problem for him, and for the nation, and for the promise of God. Because God had promised David in 2 Samuel chapter 7 that his dominion, his kingship will be forever. So Hezekiah did not have a son. And so if he had died, if he would die at that moment, then there would not be an heir to his throne. Not only that, for the people of God, for the city of Jerusalem, they knew that the Assyrians were already out there. Now they find out that their king was not only ill, but he was deathly ill. And so they were probably almost in a panic. But I love what Hezekiah does. This is what a godly man does. We've already seen him do this in chapter 37 when his representatives, his people, told him about what the commander of the Assyrian army said about them and about their God. And remember the first thing he did in chapter 37 was he went to the Lord, he went to the temple to pray and to ask for the Lord's help. Here he does the same thing. People of God, people who understand who their God is, people who understand who Christ is and who they are in Christ. First instinct, it becomes a first instinct for us to run to the Lord in prayer. Look at what he says, verses 2 and 3. Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord. Remember, O Lord, how I walked before you faithfully and with wholehearted devotion and have done what was good in your eyes. And Hezekiah wept bitterly. First thing I want us to notice here is look at in verse 2. It says he turned his face to the wall, and not only did he pray, but look at who he was praying to. How is that word Lord spelled? Capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. It's talking about the covenant-making name of God. He was praying to the only true God. He knew who God was. He knew who his God was, and he knew who could help him. And so he turned to God. It is very common for us today when we face problems. Sometimes we would say, well, you know, I've done this thing, or I heard someone say that for you to be able to sell your house, you can buy a statue of Joseph and bury it in your front yard. Well, I tell you what, it's not going to make your house sell faster. You'll just ruin your front yard by digging it up. But the people of God, like Hezekiah, knew who to turn to. They turned to the Lord. Let me ask you this. Who do you turn to when trouble comes? Who is it that you pray to? A lot of people would go to horoscopes. Even Christians, I know, they would read their horoscopes and try to find what their life is going to be for the day according to their horoscopes. Well, your horoscope will not tell you anything except to deceive you. Only God will hear your prayers. Not only that, he says, look at verse 3. Lord, remember, O Lord, how I walked before you faithfully with wholehearted devotion and have done what is good in your eyes. And then he wept bitterly. It is natural for him or for any one of us to go through, to face death and to be able to say, oh my goodness, we're going to die. Or I'm going to die. Or someone in my family is going to die. When Fred and I went over to see Carrie Reeves and her family after Carrie found her mom dead last Wednesday, there was grief. There was real grief, but there's always real grief. I know Mary, her mom, had been sick. I know, and they knew this. The doctor wanted to put her in the hospital. But death is one of those things that is always a shock to us. It is never easy. And him weeping bitterly was something that is to be understood, and it's a common thing for all of us, a common response for all of us. But I want you also to see something here. In fact, when you read verse 3, you might think, well, he's kind of like telling God, okay, look what I've done. Aren't you impressed with me? Tit for tat, I've done this, so now, okay, I've kind of sounded like he's bribed God with his good words, and now God owed him something. But I want you to look at the language that he uses. He says, remember, O Lord, how I walked before you faithfully and with wholehearted devotion and have done what is good in your eyes. You know what he was doing here? He was recalling to mind the covenant that God made. What God said in Deuteronomy chapter 7. Remember the word remember when you see it in the Old Testament. When God remembered Noah, or when God remembered Abraham, Genesis 18 and 19, with the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. Or when the psalmist calls for God to remember, or God says, I remember. When Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me, it is talking about the covenant that God had made with his people. And it's a recalling, meaning that he will be faithful to what he has said to them, the promises that he has giving them. And this is what he was doing. Remember, O Lord, how I walked before you. Remember your covenant. What was the covenant of God? Chapter 7 of Deuteronomy. Let me just read this to you. Just listen to this. This is what God was telling them. If you pay attention to these laws and are careful to follow them, then the Lord your God will keep his covenant of love with you as he swore to your ancestors. He will love you and bless you and increase your numbers. He will bless the fruit of your womb, the crops of your land, the grain, new wine, and olive oil, the calves of your herds, and the lambs of your flocks in the land he swore to your ancestors to give you. You will be blessed more than any other people. None of your men or women will be childless, nor will any of your livestock be without young. The Lord will keep you free from every disease. He will not inflict on you the horrible diseases you knew in Egypt, but he will inflict them on all who hate you. And you know what Isaiah's title is saying? He's saying basically, God, this is what you said in your word. And I'm taking you at your word, and I'm coming to you because of what you have said. Remember your word. And that was his appeal to the Lord. Well, look at God's response. Verses 4 through 6. Then the word of the Lord came to Isaiah, go and tell Hezekiah, this is what the Lord, the God of your father David, says. I love this text, by the way. I hope you read it with hearts that open to what God has to say to us and what he is saying to us about our God. Oftentimes we are so, our vision is so clouded by the circumstances that we face that we don't see the glory, the compassion, the closeness, the grace of our God. But listen to what it says. And the word of the Lord came to Isaiah, go tell Hezekiah, this is what Yahweh, the God of your father David, says. I love this. It says, I have heard your prayer. I have heard your prayer. How many times have you come to the Lord in prayer and you thought your prayers were just going as far as the ceiling was? How many times you did not go to prayer? You did not pray to the Lord because you didn't think he would even hear it. You almost seemed foolish for even saying a prayer because you're going, is this really for real? Listen to what he says. I have heard your prayer. But not only that, look at what it says again. And seen your tears. Some of you have cried in the privacy of your own homes when no one is looking, in your car by yourself. You didn't want to bother your loved ones. You didn't want them to share the burdens that you're shouldering. And you probably have even thought that no one knows, no one cares about what's going on in your life. Listen. The God that you call your God, if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior, not only hears your prayer, but he sees your tears. And then he says this, I love this. He says, I will add 15 years to your life. I will add 15 years to your life. James tells us that the prayer of a righteous man is effective and accomplishes much. The Lord tells us that we do not have because we do not ask. And when we ask with our own motives to advance our own personal interests instead of understanding the heart of God. I know what some of you are thinking. I thought LaTanya told us from Psalm 139 that all the days you ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. And in Job chapter 14, verse 5, where it says, man's days are determined. You have decreed the number of his months and have set limits that no man can exceed. Yes, he is the God who gives life, and he's the God who calls us home to him, or will send people who have rejected Christ to hell. Yes. But in terms of our relationship with him, in terms of us asking him, he responds to the prayers of his people. He responds to the prayers of his people. I don't know if this is a similar thing. I don't know really all of the things. When we get to heaven, maybe we can ask the Lord. One of our church members, Jim Etheridge, they were so sure about his diagnosis that he had this cancer that was all over his body. And then I get the text a week and a half later from Jerry, his wife, from Jerry. And she said, the doctor thinks that maybe it's not that because it's inconsistent with what they think the lab results or whatever test that they had done. And sure enough, it wasn't. It's some kind of infection that he has. And he's still dealing with that infection. They're treating that. But he's not looking at what he thought he was looking at. Saying goodbye to his family. I don't know if that's what it was, or I don't know if it's the answer to their prayers and to the prayers that's been offered to them. And I'm sure if I open the floor for a lot of you, for several of you who would say that I have asked specifically for things from the Lord and He granted those to me. Our life as a family has been that way. We asked the things from the Lord and He answered them. And I've told you about one time when I couldn't walk. I could barely even limp to take a shower, and yet God healed my hip and allowed me to walk all day the following day. Does God do that? Yes. Does He always do that? No. We trust His sovereign care for us, and we can trust Him. But one thing that He wants us to do, that is obvious in the text, is that He wants us to come to Him in prayer. He wants us to lay out our specific needs before Him, and He wants us to trust Him enough that He hears us. And He tells us in the Word, not just in this text, but all over the Bible, that He hears our prayers. He sees what's going on in our lives. He understands the fears and the struggles that we have. And He's perfectly capable, and He's a good and gracious God and Father to us, if we will trust Him. If we will pray the way that Hezekiah prayed. Not defined by the parameters of just selfishly the things that we want so that we can advance ourselves, but we understand the heart of God, and so we cry out to Him, no matter what's going on, that no matter what's going on, we want what He's already said in His Word, that we understand, and we may not understand fully everything about the Word of God, but the little that we know, we pray according to His will. Wasn't that what the Lord Jesus Christ told His disciples when they asked Him to teach us how to pray? What does He tell them? This is how you should pray. Our Father, you pray to God the Father. Holy be your name. Your kingdom come. That has to be the priority of the believer's heart. Your kingdom come. Let your rule be on this earth the way you rule in heaven today. And it will come. But the heart that we have is, Lord, would you do it now? Come, Lord Jesus, come quickly. Maranatha. That's what we're supposed to be praying. And this is what the Lord says. Not only will I give you 15 years to your life, by the way, it's in those 15 years that He had a son, an heir that was born to Him. And He says, and I will deliver you in the city from the hand of the king of Assyria. It says, I will defend the city. Does God hear our prayers? Yes. Does God care about what's going on in our lives? Yes. Does God see what's in our hearts, the fears and the struggles that we have? The answer is yes. And this is what verse 7, this is the Lord. This is the Lord's sign to you that the Lord will do what He has promised. I will make the shadow cast by the sun go back the 10 steps. It has gone down on the stairways of Ahaz. Stairway of Ahaz. So the sunlight went back 10 steps. It had gone down. So basically, the shadow just went back. It was a miraculous sign for him. Now, do we have a sign today? Now, please don't do that. I mean, people still do that today. So, you know, I put out a fleece out there like Gideon did. Well, don't do that. I tell you, a rule of thumb, when you're looking at the scriptures, what God had done once in the scriptures, that is not a pattern, unless He says so. If it's a pattern, He would repeat it like in the epistles, over and over and over again. Okay? When you see an account, a narrative in the scriptures, where there's a record like this sign here, it was a sign to Hezekiah. Remember what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, it says, Greeks look for wisdom and Jews look for signs. He said, but we preach Christ crucified. Why was he saying that? Because in Christ, in all of this, now that it's completed, we have every sign that we need. You and I can trust what God has already said in His Word. So that's what happened. And then I just want us to look at this. I just want us to read this part here. This is a psalm that he wrote as a thanksgiving for the Lord, to the Lord. Beginning verse 9, the writing of Hezekiah, king of Judah, after his illness and recovery. This is what he said. I stand in the prime of my life. He describes in verses 10 through 14 the struggle that he had. He said, in the prime of my life, must I go through the gates of death or Hades and be robbed of the rest of my years? I said, I will not see the Lord in the land of the living. No longer will I look at mankind or be with those who now dwell in this world. Like a shepherd's tent, my house has been pulled down and taken from me. Like a weaver, I have rolled up my life, and he has cut me off from the loom. Day and night she made an end of me. I waited patiently till dawn, but like a lion he broke all my bones. Day and night you made an end of me. I cried like a swift or a thrush. I moaned like a morning dove, which meant that he didn't even have the strength to be able to really cry out. My eyes were weak as I looked to the heavens. I am troubled, O Lord, come to my aid. Now, how many of us have never been through that? Look at beginning verse 15. But what can I say? He recognizes things about the Lord. He has spoken to me, and he himself has done this. Understand something about the sovereignty of God. There is nothing, there is no circumstance, no hardship, no trial, no demonic oppression that can come before you that is not within, under the sovereign power of our Almighty God and our gracious Father. Which means that what the Apostle Paul tells us in the book of Romans, that there is no more judgment for us, that he who is perfectly the one who can judge us is the one who saved us, and he prays for us. And so he assures us that there's nothing in this world, no life, no death, no circumstances, no angels, no demons can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. In fact, Psalm 119, a couple of verses there, it talks about, it says, if you have not afflicted me, I would not have known your decrees. And then he says, I will walk humbly all my years because of this anguish of my soul. Lord, by such things men live, and by my spirit finds life in them too. You restore me to health and let me live. He recognized that God was the one, just as God was the one who allowed his illness to come before him. God was the one who healed him. Surely it was for my benefit that I suffered such anguish. And I think again about that Psalm in Psalm 119. Turn there, I can't remember the text exactly. But it says, before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I obey your word. See, he had trusted the king of Assyria, tried to bribe him, stripped the temple of all the gold and the silver to bribe the king of Assyria. But now he's been afflicted, and now he turns to the Lord. Sometimes affliction will allow us to get back to the Lord, get our priorities right, allow us to be able to see things in their proper perspective. And then it says, he said, surely it was for my benefit that I suffered such anguish in your love. You kept me from the pit of destruction. You have put all my sins behind your back. For the grave cannot praise you, death cannot sing your praise. Those who go down to the pit cannot hope for your faithfulness. The living, they praise you, as I am doing today. Fathers, tell your children about your faithfulness. Fathers, tell their children about their faithfulness. Not only do we praise God in the congregation, are we willing to just stand up and proclaim what God has done in our lives, but we tell our kids, we write them down, and we tell them stories as they're going to bed. This is the God of your fathers, this is my God, and this is how faithful he is, and this is what he's done for me. I encourage you that, to do that. The Lord will save me, and we will sing with stringed instruments all the days of our lives in the temple of the Lord. He's saying he's committing himself to a life of worship. Isaiah had said, prepare a poultice of figs and apply it to the boil, and he will recover. The prophet of God also became the doctor that God had sent. Hezekiah had asked, what will be the sign that I will go up to the temple of the Lord? And of course, we saw that sign about the shadow going backwards. Let me just give you four truths that we can take from this. Number one, going back to his heritage, to Hezekiah's heritage. And I think about this, about people who come to me for counseling, sometimes just in one-on-one visiting, and they'll tell me, well, you need to understand where I came from. You need to understand how my parents were. Well, let me tell you. First thing is, you cannot blame the faults of your father for how you are today. Your past may explain to me things about you, but you and I, dads, let me speak to you, men, let me speak to you. You and I, as we lead our families, as we lead our wives, we need to understand that you are not imprisoned to your past. If Christ is real in you, if you know Christ as your Savior, then the power of Christ, the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ, has freed you from any of those things. Yes, you will still struggle emotionally. Yes, there will be some quote-unquote psychological problems with you. But you stand on what God has said, and who He is, and who you are in Christ. You know, one of the most common things I do when people come to me in counseling or when I'm teaching and they tell me about their problems, I say, find out who you are in Christ. Read Ephesians 1, 2, and 3. Find out who you are, because that is who you are. Your past may explain things about you, but it cannot excuse you. Second, the better you know God, the quicker you run to Him in prayer. God on speed dial. When you're in trouble, what do? A lot of us, we go, oh, why is this going to me? We wring our hands. We love to wring our hands. I'm surprised we don't have really, really just thin skin in our hands, though, as much as we wring our hands. I've thought about it before, you know, when the Lord says, stop worrying about what you will eat, what you will drink. And I thought, you know, it would be great if every time we worry about something, a worry wart would pop out of our faces. And we can really see who's starting to worry. Because really, when you know God, when you know that He is the good, gracious God who is sovereignly controlling everything, and He's the one who loved us enough to send His Son. And that's the reasoning that Paul makes. He said that if He was willing to do that, to give us His Son, while we were still sinners, what makes us think that He's not going to give us all these things? And that's what Jesus was saying in Luke chapter 12. He said, why do you worry about the little things in life? And He calls them the little things, about what you will eat, you know, the everyday necessities that we have, that we need. And He said, your Father is pleased to give you the kingdom. It's talking about the kingdom. The kingdom of God is going to be given to us. He'll hand it to us. And we worry about what we will eat, how we're going to pay our bills, what's going to happen. We can trust God. But see, the better we know God, the quicker we run things. Third, the better you know God, the more you pray according to His will. So it's no longer what Lacan wants, but we understand what the will of God is. And we pray, and I hope we could take in the Word of God out of context. God, you promised this. And it's not even what God is saying. But we pray according to His will. And in that, and pray the will of God, we can have confidence that He hears us. He always hears us anyway. But that He will answer our prayers. And then fourth is this, which is what we've been talking about. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. I bet you, well, I shouldn't bet, but so long as the proceeds go to missions. But if I ask every one of us here, I would dare say that majority of the people in this room this morning, the majority of Christians, struggle with this idea that God will answer our prayer. And maybe you're right. Maybe because we're not even walking with the Lord, we don't even know His will, and so we don't know how to pray. And I just want to encourage you, especially men, as we meet our families, our wives, families, as we spend time with other men, with younger men. Prayer is one of the most important things that we do. I think about over the years when Michael and Joshua lived, they loved soccer, real football. They loved real football.
Whoa.
Not American football. I heard the groaning and the moaning of those. But what did I do? I didn't know much soccer, but I knew one thing about soccer. You get a ball, a round ball, real football, and you kick it around. And Michael and Josh grew up with just a soccer ball, and then they'd go to camps, and they practiced, they became part of teams, and they did that. You know, if I could do that for my children, for my boys, why would I not teach them? Why would I not do that which is most important in my role as a father to them? I can teach them sports, and they're not even playing professional soccer. They're not even playing recreation soccer today. They're out of shape, I think. But he's not upset. But if that's okay, for the time being, you know, we enjoyed soccer. We still enjoy watching soccer and a lot of sports. But if that's so important that I would invest the kind of time and energy in a sport, why would I not invest as a dad, as a grandfather, in that which is most important, that will affect not only their life for a moment, for a time, for a season in their life, but for eternity? Why would I not do that? And it's the most basic and yet the most wonderful and one of the most important things that we can do as men is to get down on our knees before God our Father and pray. Well, F.B. Meyer was, you can still buy a lot of his books, he's a scholar, but he was a pastor, an English pastor, who was a friend with guys like, D.L. Moody. But he was crossing the Atlantic one time in one of those steam liners. That's how far back he lived. And the captain of the ship asked him to speak to the first class passengers. And so he spoke to them about answered prayer. There was an atheist who was there. And when asked about what he thought about what Dr. F.B. Meyer said, he said, there's a bunch of whatever he said, you know, he's just a babbler. Well, the next day, the captain asked him again, F.B. Meyer, Dr. Meyer, to speak to the ones in the, I guess, the cabin type areas, common areas. Again, he spoke about answered prayer. Well, guess who was there? It was the atheist again. And somebody said, well, I thought you didn't believe in this stuff. He said, I just want to see what, I just want to hear what this babbler said. But before he went to hear Dr. Meyer, he thought, well, he just, out of nowhere, he just thought about it. He grabbed a couple of oranges and stuck them in his pockets. Well, on the way to hear Dr. Meyer, he saw a lady sitting in a chair, asleep with her hands like this. He thought she was asleep. And so he thought, well, I just kind of had fun with her. He took the oranges out and put them on her hands, both her hands. And then he went on to hear Dr. Meyer, this babbler. And when he left, he saw this lady enjoying the oranges. And he said, did you enjoy are you enjoying the oranges? He said, oh yeah, this is great, this is wonderful, my father gave it to me. Is it your father? Is he still alive? Because the lady was elderly. And he said, oh yeah, he's very much alive. I'm talking about my father in heaven. He says, what do you mean your father in heaven? And she said, well, earlier I was sitting here, I've been seasick for the last 3 days. And I was just praying, says, Lord, would you give me an orange? Just let me eat an orange. And not only did he give me one, but he gave me two. This man got to visit with Dr. Meyer, this atheist, and through the testimony of the lady and the testimony of the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ, he too became a believer. Our God loves for us to come to him in prayer. I want to, there's another gift that we have for the men, maybe for the families, but I want the men to pick them up. And really when I was looking at our schedule for this week for Father's Day, I thought 3 weeks ago, in fact I told our staff, I said I wish I had the time to write a 31-day devotional, just a short guide for prayer. But I didn't have the time 3 weeks ago, the last 3 weeks. And guess what? Family in our church had, well, the husband texted me a while back and he said, would you like to get a book to be given to every family in our church written by Dr. Jack Brown? And I said, sure. I didn't know what it was. Well, the books came in last week. And I opened it last Sunday in my office. Guess what the book was or is about? It's a 31-day prayer guide. None of my answered prayers. Didn't have to do it myself because Dr. Brown already did it. So here's what I'd like for us to do. Men, would you just come? Whether you're single or you're married or who whoever come, and then you can either stay here or go back to your seat and just spend some time with your family. Would you do that? And spend some time in just a short prayer, just ask for God's blessings in you and your family. We're going to take time for you to come and pick up these books. So go ahead and, men, stand up and come.